The NHS has changed so much, even in the last 20 years. And I'm here to tell you a bit about that, but to show you how much has changed, I could show you different things. I could show you a graph where we look at the changes in healthcare that have happened, the changes in population. I could show you how our diseases have changed as a consequence of some of our lifestyle choices. Or I could show you a graph of how much money we're spending. We're spending more and more on healthcare, and I could show you some fantastic bits of data. But I'm not really a statistician. What I am first and foremost, and what I really love, is being a doctor. And that allows me to speak to you, really, from some experience. It also allows me to speak to you and tell you some stories. So, my grandfather was also a doctor, all 5 foot, three of him. And he lived a few years ago, and when he died, the thing that I most wanted him to hand me down was this. This is his doctor's bag. And in it, he used it every day, and he used it and kept all the tools of his trade in it. Now, my grandfather saw the eradication of illnesses in this country, using syringes and vaccinations. And this is one of the syringes that he used. And I suggest that I probably shouldn't be using this today. I mean, he used it to clean ear canals out with, not giving vaccinations. But it seems to me that the model that we have used for healthcare hasn't changed since my grandfather's time. I remember distinctly my first week as a GP 20 years ago. And in that time, I saw three types of patients. And the reality is, I've continued to see the same three types of patients since. The first commonest cause of 80% of the patients that I see, they're the patients that weren't sick yesterday, but they are today. They don't need to be seen in hospital, but need some health care. This is Alex. He's a child, he's sick, not very well, needs some care. The second type represents about 18% of the patients we see. They have a long-term condition. They need some advice on how to manage their condition and how to get better. We'll call that patient Christine. Let's say Christine has type 2 diabetes. She really needs some help and information to make sure that she stays well. The third type, and sometimes the most serious, we'll call Uncle Stephen. This represents just 2%, only about 1 in 50 of the patients we see. And they have a mix of complex conditions. And Stephen, for instance, will say he's got dementia. And he's struggling, he needs some help with where he is on a day-to-day basis. But he's using healthcare in all facilities a lot of the time. 20 years ago, Alex, Christine, and Stephen all stood in a line outside my practice at 8:30 to be seen. We were using a model of healthcare that was based on something probably from my grandfather's generation. It was an outdated model. Alex, we'd see in the surgery, and we could treat Alex, that would be okay. Christine, well, complex condition, diabetes, had to go off to the hospital. And Stephen, well, we'd struggle and settle for, you know, helping him along with his condition a bit. 10 years later, our list size had grown from 6,000 patients to 12,000 patients. It had doubled in size. And so the Alex, Christines, and Stephens were just waiting in longer and longer queues. The hand-me-down model of healthcare that we'd had was no longer fit for purpose. And so 10 years ago, a group of us GPs got together and said, we need to change. We need to see what we can do to make this better. So, what have we done? Well, for our three types of patients, we've trying to aim to fit their healthcare to their personal needs more and more. For Alex, if we have a group of GPs working together around a hub, that means Alex's mum or dad or carer can ring up the hub and get an appointment for Alex at a time that's convenient for them, in a place that's convenient for them. How do we do that? Well, by merging GP practices together and pooling their resources, you can get care that's delivered better for those patients. For Christine, by empowering the primary care team, by educating doctors, nurses, and the whole team, you can make sure that the training's in place so that her diabetes can be dealt with in primary care. She no longer has to be referred to hospital unless she's really, really sick. Through imparting knowledge and information to her, actually, Christine becomes the manager and manager of her condition. And our job is to really stand beside her and see if we can help. For our last group, we've still got a problem with dementia because we can't treat dementia. But there are things that we can do by making sure that we've got a focused package of care for the team that work with our Stephen. We can make sure that he has better health care. So Stephen's problems also become our problems, and actually with his carers we make sure that he has a much better of care based on our fact that we've got some scale that we can work with. So Alex, Christine and Stephen are no longer waiting in the same line. 10 years ago was when we made those changes. Today, we've got over 200,000 patients in our large GP practice. We've done 28 mergers of all the GP practices, and that means we can make sure we deliver care in a better way. And using technology, we can make sure that patient journeys are shortened. For instance, if you take Christine or a patient who's got a heart condition, what we can do is we can make sure that they're seen in the community by somebody who's good at dealing with heart conditions, and then they can get the tests done in the community, and those results can be sent directly to the hospital where the consultant can see them and can read them, and actually you get a fast treatment pathway for patients. Heart disease is still one of the biggest killers we have, so the sooner we treat people, the better that is. So, my grandfather would never have imagined a world where this was possible. But that doesn't mean we should settle for what we've been handed down. By making small changes on a regular basis, we can incrementally improve so that what we hand on to our next generation is way better. If we dream bigger, the service we provide to our patients can be better tomorrow. I don't know what kind of bag you brought with you today. It could be a designer handbag. It could be a 5p carrier bag, or it could be an old stuffy leather doctor's bag like this. But we shouldn't let the arc of history dictate our future. Things can change if we choose to make them. This is my grandfather's bag. It's not worth anything, but because I love my grandfather, it's a symbol of something that's really important to me. So healthcare shouldn't be something that's left in a loft. It shouldn't be a legacy to preserve, or it shouldn't be something that we reminisce over. However, it is something we inherit. It's something we can mould and something that we can improve. Now, I've grown up a bit since the days when my grandfather was around. I've got my family of my own. And actually, when my time comes, looking at my doctor's bag, my daughters tell me that they really don't want it. But for Alex, Christine and Stephen, they will be different for our future generations and future generations to come. But I think we have a duty. We have a duty to make sure that our healthcare is not just a hand-me-down. Thank you.